Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Black Against Empire, The History and Politics of the Black Panther Party by Joshua Bloom and Waldo E. Martin, Jr. Narrated by Ron Butler. When, in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bonds which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident: that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its power in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same object, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty, to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Declaration of Independence, July 4, 1776, as excerpted in the Black Panther Party's original 10-point program, Black Panther, May 15, 1967. Introduction. The Panthers shut out the pack of zealous reporters and kept the door locked all day, but now the hallway was empty. Huey Newton and two comrades casually walked from the luxury suite down to the lobby and slipped out of the Hong Kong Hilton. Their official escort took them straight across the border, and after a short flight, they exited the plane in Beijing, where they were greeted by cheering throngs. It was late September 1971, and U.S. National Security Advisor Henry Kissinger had just visited China a couple months earlier. The United States was proposing a visit to China by President Nixon himself and looking toward normalization of diplomatic relations. The Chinese leaders held varied views of these prospects and had not yet revealed whether they would accept a visit from Nixon. But the Chinese government had been in frequent communication with the Black Panther Party, had hosted a Panther delegation a year earlier, and had personally invited Huey Newton, the party's leader, to visit. With Nixon attempting to arrange a visit, Newton decided to accept the invitation and beat Nixon to China. When Zhou Enlai, the Chinese premier, greeted Newton in Beijing, Newton took Zhou's right hand between both his hands. Zhou clasped Newton's wrist with his left hand, and the two men looked deeply into each other's eyes. Newton presented a formal petition requesting that China negotiate with Nixon for the freedom of the oppressed peoples of the world. Then the two sat down for a private meeting. On National Day, the October 1st anniversary of the founding of the People's Republic of China, Premier Zhou honored the Panthers as national guests. Tens of thousands of Chinese gathered in Tiananmen Square, waving red flags and applauding the Panthers. Revolutionary theater groups, folk dancers, acrobats, and revolutionary ballet performed. Huge red banners declared, "Peoples of the world, unite to destroy the American aggressors and their lackeys." At the official state dinner, First Lady Jiang Xing sat with the Panthers. A New York Times editorial encouraged Nixon to think positively about Communist China and to ignore such potential sources of friction as the honor shown to Black Panther leader Huey Newton. Forbidden History. In Oakland, California, in late 1966, community college students Bobby Seale and Huey Newton took up arms and declared themselves part of a global revolution against American imperialism. Unlike civil rights activists who advocated for full citizenship rights within the United States, their Black Panther Party rejected the legitimacy of the U.S. government. The Panthers saw black communities in the United States as a colony, and the police as an occupying army. In a foundational 1967 essay, Newton wrote, "Because black people desire to determine their own destiny, they are constantly inflicted with brutality from the occupying army, embodied in the police department. There is a great similarity between the occupying army in Southeast Asia and the occupation of our communities by the racist police." As late as February 1968, the Black Panther Party was still a small local organization. But that year, everything changed. By December, the party had opened offices in 20 cities, from Los Angeles to New York. In the face of numerous armed conflicts with police and virulent direct repression by the state, young black people embraced the revolutionary vision of the party. And by 1970, the party had opened offices in 68 cities, from Winston-Salem to Omaha and Seattle. The Black Panther Party had become the center of a revolutionary movement in the United States. Listeners today may have difficulty imagining a revolution in the United States. But in the late 1960s, many thousands of young black people, despite the potentially fatal outcome of their actions, joined the Black Panther Party and dedicated their lives to revolutionary struggle. Many more approved of their efforts. A joint report by the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI, the Central Intelligence Agency, Defense Intelligence Committee, and National Security Agency expressed grave concern about wide support for the party among young blacks, noting that 43% of blacks under 21 years of age have a great respect for the Black Panther Party. Students for a Democratic Society, the leading anti-war and draft resistance organization, declared the Black Panther Party the vanguard in our common struggles against capitalism and imperialism. FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover famously declared, "The Black Panther Party, without question, represents the greatest threat to the internal security of the country." As the Black Panthers drew young blacks to their revolutionary program, the party became the strongest link between the domestic black liberation struggle and global opponents of American imperialism. The North Vietnamese, at war with the United States, sent letters home to the families of American prisoners of war, POWs, through the Black Panther Party, and discussed releasing POWs in exchange for the release of Panthers from U.S. jails. Cuba offered political asylum to Black Panthers and began developing a military training ground for them. Algeria, then the center of Pan-Africanism and a world hub of anti-imperialism that hosted embassies for most post-colonial governments and independence movements, granted the Panthers national diplomatic status and an embassy building of their own, where the Panthers headquartered their international section under the leadership of Eldridge and Kathleen Cleaver. But by the time of Newton's trip to China, the Black Panther Party had begun to unravel. In the early 1970s, the party rapidly declined. By mid-1972, it was basically a local Oakland community organization once again. An award-winning elementary school and a brief local renaissance in the mid-1970s notwithstanding, the party suffered a long and painful demise, formally closing its last office in 1982. Not since the Civil War, almost 150 years ago, have so many people taken up arms in revolutionary struggle in the United States. Of course, the number of people who took up arms for the Union and Confederate causes, and the number of people killed in the Civil War, are orders of magnitude larger than the numbers who have engaged in any armed political struggle in the United States since. Some political organizations that embraced revolutionary ideologies yet eschewed armed confrontation with the state may have garnered larger followings than the Black Panther Party did. But in the general absence of armed revolution in the United States since 1865, the thousands of Black Panthers who dedicated their lives to a political program involving armed resistance to state authority stand alone. Why in the late 1960s, in contrast to the civil rights movement's nonviolent action and demands for African Americans' full participation in U.S. society, and despite severe personal risks, did so many young people dedicate their lives to the Black Panther Party and embrace armed revolution? Why, after a few years of explosive growth, did the party so quickly unravel? And why has no similar movement developed since? Most obvious explanations do not stand up to the evidence. Some believe the party was a creation of the media. But most of the media attention came after the party's rapid spread. Some assert that the party's success was just a product of the times. But many other Black political organizations, some with similar ideologies, sought to mobilize people at the same time, and none succeeded like the Panthers. Others contend that this or that Panther leader was an unrivaled organizer, and that by the force of his or her efforts, the party was able to recruit its vast following. But most of the new recruits to the Black Panthers came to the party asking to join, not the other way around. One common view is that the party collapsed because it could not withstand the government's repression. But the year of greatest repression, 1969, was also the year of the party's greatest growth. While much has been written on aspects of the Black Panther Party, none of the accounts to date have offered a rigorous, overarching analysis of the party's evolution and impact. Most writers have looked at a small slice of the party's temporal and geographic scope, providing limited historical context. Party sympathizers are as guilty of such reduction as its detractors are. Commentators reduce the party to its community service programs or to armed confrontation with the police. They claim the Panthers espoused narrowly Marxist or Black nationalist ideology. They maintain that Huey Newton was a genius, or that he was overly philosophical, or that he was a criminal. They say the party's power came from organizing young Blacks from the urban ghettos, or that its influence stemmed from its ability to draw broad support from a range of allies. To some people, the party was a locus of cutting-edge debate on gender politics, and they applaud its embrace of women's and gay liberation. To others, it was sexist and patriarchal. Occasionally, commentators have even suggested that the Black Panther Party was all of these things. But no one has made sense of the relationship among the parts, situated the varying practices of the party in time and place, and adequately trace the evolution of the party's politics. As Pulitzer Prize-winning historian David Garrow recently pointed out in an extensive review of historical works on the Panthers, no one has yet offered a serious analysis of how the political practices of the Black Panther Party changed during its history, or why people were drawn to participate at each juncture of its evolution. Panther scholarship, Garrow observes, would benefit immensely from a detailed and comprehensive narrative history that gives special care to how rapidly the Black Panther Party evolved through a succession of extremely fundamental changes. Far too much of what has been written about the party fails to specify expressly which period of Panther history is being addressed or characterized, and interpretive clarity and accuracy will benefit greatly from a far more explicit appreciation and identification of the major turning points in the Black Panther Party's eventually tragic evolution. Writing in the New York Times in 1994, sociologist Robert Blauner commented, Because of the political minefields, the complex and textured social history that the Panthers deserve has not yet been written, and may be 10 or 15 years in the future. More than 40 years have passed since the heyday of the Black Panther Party, and almost 20 years have passed since Blauner's writing. But to date, despite comment by a diversity of writers, no one has presented an adequate or comprehensive history. As a popular adage suggests, history is written by the victors. Writing a history that transcends preconceptions is challenging. It takes time and perspective and endless sifting through often contradictory evidence to test competing explanations and weigh the importance of divergent forces. But the lack of an overarching history of the Panthers and their politics, despite the abundance of writing on various aspects of the party, is unusual. We suspect that the long absence of an adequate history is due, in part, to the character of state repression of the party. Aimed specifically at vilifying the Black Panther Party, state repression powerfully shaped public understandings and blurred the outlines of the history. The federal government and local police forces across the nation responded to the Panthers with an unparalleled campaign of repression and vilification. They fed defamatory stories to the press. They wiretapped Panther offices around the country. They hired dozens of informants to infiltrate Panther chapters. Often, they put aside all pretense and simply raided Panther establishments, guns blazing. In one case, in Chicago in December 1969, equipped with an informant's map of the apartment, police and federal agents assassinated a prominent Panther leader in his bed while he slept, shooting him in the head at point-blank range. In attacking the Black Panthers as enemies of the state, federal agents sought to repress not just the party as an organization, but the political possibility it represented. The FBI's counterintelligence program, COINTELPRO, sought to vilify the Black Panthers and prevent the party and similar black nationalist groups and leaders from gaining respectability by discrediting them. FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover emphasized time and again, in different ways, that one of our primary aims in counterintelligence as it concerns the BPP is to keep this group isolated from the moderate black and white community which may support it. Federal agents sought to create factionalism among party leaders and between the Panthers and other black political organizations. FBI operatives forged documents and paid provocateurs to promote violent conflicts between Black Panther leaders, as well as between the party and other black nationalist organizations, and congratulated themselves when these conflicts yielded the killing of Panthers. And COINTELPRO sought to lead the party into unsupportable action, creating opposition to the BPP on the part of the majority of the residents of the ghetto areas. For example, agent provocateurs on the government payroll supplied explosives to Panther members and sought to incite them to blow up public buildings, and they promoted kangaroo courts encouraging Panther members to torture suspected informants. One school of commentators simply took up Hoover's program of vilification, portraying the party as criminals and obscuring and minimizing its politics. In an influential article in 1978, Kate Coleman and Paul Avery made a series of allegations about personal misdeeds and criminal actions by Panthers in the 1970s, after the party had lost influence as a national and international political organization. Black Panthers have committed a series of violent crimes over the last several years. There appears to be no political explanation for it. The party is no longer under siege by the police, and this is not self-defense. It seems to be nothing but senseless criminality, directed in most cases at other blacks. David Horowitz wrote a series of essays in 1994 building on these allegations, treating them as the totality of what was important or interesting about the Panthers, and describing the Black Panthers as an organized street gang. Hugh Pearson, in consultation with Horowitz, then wrote The Shadow of the Panther, a full-length book version of the story Horowitz had developed, telling the history of the Black Panther Party through the alleged crimes and personal misdeeds of Huey Newton. The major newspapers celebrated the book as a respectable history of the party and its politics. The New York Times called the book a richly detailed portrait of a movement and named it one of its notable books of the year 1994. The storm of criminal allegations, touted as movement history, effectively advanced J. Edgar Hoover's program of vilifying the party and shrouding its politics. While many of the criminal allegations that Horowitz and his colleagues made about Huey Newton and other Panther leaders were thinly supported, and almost none were verified in court, these treatments also omit and obscure the thousands of people who dedicated their lives to the Panther Revolution, their reasons for doing so, and the political dynamics of their participation, their actions, and the consequences. Hoover's program aimed to drive a wedge between the party and its non-black allies. Today, the popular misconception persists that the Black Panther Party was separatist or anti-white. Many current internet postings mischaracterize the party in this way. In fact, the party was deeply anti-racist and strongly committed to interracial coalitions. Even some newspapers got the basic story wrong, such as the Providence Journal Bulletin, whose editorial board characterized the party as an organization based on racial hostility, a mirror image of the Ku Klux Klan. Such misconceptions have also taken root among some of today's young activists seeking to emulate the historical example of the Black Panthers, such as the so-called New Black Panther Party, darling of Fox News, which, while claiming to carry on the legacy of the original Black Panthers, preaches separatism and racial hate. Another influential line of attack, the argument that the Panthers primarily advanced black macho rather than a broader liberation politics, has also done more to obscure than to illuminate the history of the party. Michelle Wallace first popularized this argument in her influential 1978 book, Black Macho and the Myth of Superwoman, in which she denigrates the role of Angela Davis and other revolutionary black women as do-it-for-your-man selfless subservience to misogyny in the name of black liberation. As June Jordan commented in a 1979 review, Black Macho is a divisive, fractious tract, devoid of hope and dream, devoid even of competent scholarship for the subject so glibly undertaken. Yet, the argument gained traction, perhaps in part because it built upon a kernel of truth. Stewarding a predominantly male organization in the beginning, some Black Panthers indeed asserted an aggressive black masculinity. But by misrepresenting this black masculinism as the totality of the party's politics, Wallace and her ilk distorted and defamed the party. They erased the women who soon constituted a majority of the Panther membership and devalued the considerable struggles Panther women and men undertook to advance gender and sexual liberation within and through the party, often progressing well in advance of the wider society. If J. Edgar Hoover were alive today, he would undoubtedly take great pride in the persistence of the factionalism he sought to create among the Panthers. Fights that erupted between Panther factions as the party lost its national and international political influence in the 1970s have long outlived the organization. Decades later, former Black Panther leaders continue to condemn each other virulently in public. These disputes distract from the politics of the Black Panthers in their heyday and sustain the party's public vilification. But in recent decades, the history of the Black Panther Party has proven irrepressible. Memoirs by former Black Panthers, as well as scholarly books, edited collections, articles, doctoral dissertations, and master's theses have chipped away at public fallacies, clearing obscurity and uncovering the history of the party piece by piece. memoirs by and biographies of Black Panther activists who served in various parts of the country, and some who were national leaders, including David Hilliard, Elbert Big Man Howard, Asada Shakur, Geronimo Pratt, Elaine Brown, Sophia Bukhari, Stokely Carmichael, Marshall Eddie Conway, Floris Forbes, Evan Hopkins, Mumia Abu-Jamal, Steve McCutcheon, Robert Hillary King, Huey P. Newton, Afeni Shakur, and Johnny Spain, provide personal perspectives and rich accounts of life in the party. Edited collections by Kathleen Cleaver and George Katsiafikas, Judson Jeffries, Charles Jones, Yuhuru Williams, and Jama Lazaro, and countless journal articles, fill out the story of local chapters in cities across the country and develop thematic insights across them. Books on the Panthers by Paul Alkibalan, Curtis Austin, Christian Davenport, Donna Murch, Jane Rhodes, as well as more general recent books that contain significant discussions of the Panthers, build analytic perspective. A new generation of scholars has provided rigorous treatments of myriad facets of the party's history, producing the extraordinary number of 90 dissertations and master's theses, most written in the last decade, analyzing specific aspects of the party's history, such as the sickle cell anemia programs, the multiracial alliances of the Chicago Panthers, or the artwork of Black Panther Minister of Culture, Emery Douglas. These previous treatments are invaluable, and the depth of our analysis is much richer for them. But despite the strength of many of these contributions, none has presented a complete picture of the Black Panther Party, or an adequate analysis of its politics. Pinning down history is always complex. The vociferous efforts of the federal government to vilify the Panthers, and the legacy of factional dispute, made the history of the Black Panther Party nearly impenetrable. How we wrote this book. What is unique and historically important about the Black Panther Party is specifically its politics. So, in seeking to uncover the history of the Black Panther Party, we have sought to analyze the party's political history. In an early proposal for the book in 2000, we elaborated a method of strategic genealogy to conduct this analysis. Rather than center our analysis on particular individuals or on dissection of the party's organization, we uncovered the political dynamics of the party by studying the evolution of its political practices. We could not have written this book without the insight we gained talking with former Panthers, especially David Hilliard, former Black Panther Chief of Staff, and Kathleen Cleaver, former Black Panther Communications Secretary. We also benefited from getting to know almost all of the other living former leaders of the Black Panther Party. And together with our students, we spoke with many regional leaders, rank-and-file members of the party, and important party allies, including Bobby Seale, Elaine Brown, Erica Huggins, Angela Davis, Emery Douglas, Billy X. Jennings, Mumia Abu-Jamal, Geronimo Jijaga Pratt, Richard Aoki, Kumasi Aguila, Alex Papillon, Melvin Newton, John Seale, Tom Hayden, and dozens of others. The hundreds of hours we spent talking about the party and working with former members on related historical projects provided invaluable insight into life inside the party and the crucial concerns of the leadership at various junctures. When we began the project in the late 1990s, we conducted formal interviews with Bobby Seale and a range of others, expecting that these conversations would be the main source of data for the project. But the more interviews we conducted, the clearer the limits of that medium became. Retrospective accounts decades after the fact, with memories shaped by intervening events, interests, and hearsay, are highly contradictory. So, although we did rely extensively on conversations with historical actors to test our analysis and push our understanding, We have avoided using retrospective interviews as a principal source of evidence, preferring to consult documentary or recorded evidence that was temporally proximate to the events. In the end, what made it possible to uncover this history was a vast wealth of primary sources, including many thousands of first-hand accounts of historical events offered by participants shortly after they occurred. We conducted much of the research through the Social Movements Project at the Institute for the Study of Social Change at the University of California, Berkeley, which we co-directed from 2000 to 2005. We benefited greatly from the assistance of dozens of graduate and undergraduate research assistants. Several of our graduate research assistants and advisees have gone on to complete dissertations and publish their own books on aspects of the party history. We early consulted the range of primary sources on the party already available in archives at Stanford University, the University of California, Berkeley, Howard University, the University of Wisconsin-Madison, the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, the New Haven Museum and Historical Society, and the Oakland Public Library. In articles in the Black press, underground press, and mainstream press, and in government documents. In addition, we developed two new archival sources in the course of producing this book. In our first major archival project, we assembled the only near-complete collection of the party's own newspaper, the Black Panther. This collection includes every issue published during the party's heyday from 1967 to 1971, and 520 of the 537 issues published overall. Chock full of party members' first-hand accounts of unfolding events and programmatic statements by party leaders, the Black Panther offers the most comprehensive documentation of the ideas, actions, and projections of the party day-to-day, week-to-week. Under our editorial direction, the Alexander Street Press digitized this collection, made the text searchable, and published the documents online as part of its Black Thought and Culture collection, in collaboration with Huey Newton's widow, Frederica Newton, and the Huey P. Newton Foundation. In our second major archival project, we collaborated with the H.K. Ewan family to recover, preserve, and index a good portion of the H.K. Ewan collection, which contains thousands of flyers and pamphlets and over 30,000 hours of audio recordings on the Panthers and other social movements in the Bay Area from the 1960s and 1970s. As a doctoral student in Berkeley in 1964, H.K. Ewan began collecting every movement flyer and pamphlet circulated on the Berkeley campus, and he recorded every meeting and rally in the Bay Area that he could. Ewan dropped out of school and made a career of this collection for almost two decades. He also set up an apparatus to record almost all shows about social movements broadcast on Bay Area radio stations. Working with his son, Eddie Ewan, we recovered this extensive collection from boxes overflowing the Ewan family basement, and then preserved and indexed the contents and facilitated donation of the collection, which auditors value at several million dollars, to the Bancroft Library at the University of California, Berkeley. This collaborative work thus resulted from a series of joint scholarly projects led by Bloom. As first author, Bloom did the lion's share of the research, writing, and analysis. As co-author, Martin contributed substantially to the research, writing, and analysis. In the end, each author contributed crucially to all phases of the making of this book. Black Against Empire. Civil rights activists nonviolently defied Jim Crow, demanding full citizenship rights. Their insurgent civil rights movement of the early 1960s dismantled legal segregation and expanded black enfranchisement in the United States. The 1964 Civil Rights Act and 1965 Voting Rights Act codified their inspiring victories. But once there was little legal segregation left to defy, the insurgent civil rights movement fell apart. In the late 1960s, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and Congress of Racial Equality, two organizations that led much of the nonviolent civil disobedience, imploded. The Southern Christian Leadership Conference declined. But the broader vision of black liberation that had motivated civil rights activists remained salient. Many black people, having won a measure of political incorporation, organized to win electoral political power. Many sought economic advancement. Moderate civil rights organizations, such as the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People and the Urban League, turned their attention to the hard work of civil rights enforcement. Countless activists continued to chip away at racial discrimination in jobs, education, and housing. For many blacks, the civil rights movement's victories proved limited, even illusory. Especially for young urban blacks in the North and West, little improved. The wartime jobs that drew the black migration had ended. Much remaining industry fled to the suburbs along with white residents, and many blacks lived isolated in poor urban ghettos with little access to decent employment or higher education, and with minimal political influence. Municipal police and fire departments in cities with large black populations employed few, if any, blacks. And many cities developed containment policing practices designed to isolate violence in black ghettos rather than to keep ghetto residents safe. Although black people were formerly full citizens, most remained ghettoized, impoverished, and politically subordinate, with few channels for redress. Starting in 1966, young blacks in cities across the country took up the call for black power. The black power ferment posed a question. How would black people in America win not only formal citizenship rights, but actual economic and political power? Dozens of organizations sprang up seeking to attain black power in different ways. More a question than an answer. Black power meant widely different things to different people. Despite the belief among many young blacks that their mobilization as black people was the key, no one knew how to mobilize effectively. Into this vacuum, Huey Newton and Bobby Seale advanced a black anti-imperialist politics that powerfully challenged the status quo, yet was difficult to repress. Drawing on the nationalist ideas of Malcolm X, Newton and Seale declared the Black Panther Party steward of the black community, its legitimate political representative, standing in revolutionary opposition to the oppressive power structure. But unlike many black nationalists, the Panthers made common cause with the domestic anti-war movement and anti-imperialist movements abroad. The Panthers argued that black people constituted a colony in the mother country. With an unpopular imperial war underway in Vietnam, popular anti-imperialist movements agitating internationally, and a crisis of legitimacy brewing in the Democratic Party, they posited a single worldwide struggle against imperialism encompassing Vietnamese resistance against the United States, draft resistance against military service, and their own struggle to liberate the black community. In the face of brutal repression, the Black Panther Party forged powerful alliances, drawing widespread support not only from moderate blacks, but also from many non-blacks, as well as from anti-imperialist governments and movements around the globe. The Black Panther's crucial political innovation was not only ideational, but practical. At the center of their politics was the practice of armed self-defense against the police. While revolutionary ideas could be easily ignored, widespread confrontations between young armed black people and the police could not. The Panthers' politics of armed self-defense gave them political leverage, forcibly contesting the legitimacy of the American political regime. In late 1968, Bobby Seale and David Hilliard shifted the party's focus to organizing community programs, such as free breakfasts for children. In 1969, every Panther chapter organized community services, and these programs soon became the staple activity for party members nationwide. By that summer, the party estimated it was feeding 10,000 children free breakfast every day. The Black Panther Party's community programs gave members meaningful daily activities, strengthened Black community support, burnished party credibility in the eyes of allies, and vividly exposed the inadequacy of the federal government's concurrent war on poverty. Community programs concretely advanced the politics the Panthers stood for. They were feeding hungry children when the vastly wealthier and more powerful U.S. government was allowing children to starve. The more the state sought to repress the Panthers, the more the party's allies mobilized in its defense. The Black Panther Party quickly became a major national and international political force. Individuals created the Black Panther Party. Without their specific efforts and actions, the party would not have come about. And there is little reason to believe that a powerful Black anti-imperialist movement would have developed in the late 1960s. Yet, the Black Panther Party was also specific to its times. The times did not make the Black Panther Party, but the specific practices of the Black Panthers became influential precisely because of the political context. Without the success of the insurgent civil rights movement, and without its limitations, the Black Power ferment from which the Black Panther Party emerged would not have existed. Without widespread exclusion of Black people from political representation, good jobs, government employment, quality education, and the middle class, most Black people would have opposed the Panthers' politics. Without the Vietnam War draft and the crisis of legitimacy in the Democratic Party, few non-Black allies would have mobilized resistance to state repression of the party. Without powerful anti-imperialist allies abroad, the Panthers would have been deprived of both resources and credibility. It was not simply what the Black Panthers did, but what they did in the conditions in which they found themselves that proved so consequential. They created a movement with the power to challenge established social relations, and yet, given the political context, very difficult to repress. Once the Black Panther Party developed, until the conditions under which it thrived abated, some form of revolutionary anti-imperialism would necessarily persist. Had government hiring and university enrollment remained inaccessible to Blacks, had Black electoral representation not expanded, had affirmative action programs never proliferated, had the military draft not been scaled back and then repealed, and had revolutionary governments abroad not normalized relations with the United States, revolutionary Black anti-imperialism would still be a powerful force in the United States today. While the Black Panther Party might have been repressible as an organization, the politics the Panthers created were irrepressible so long as the conditions in which they thrived persisted. From 1968 through 1970, the Black Panther Party made it impossible for the U.S. government to maintain business as usual, and it helped create a far-reaching crisis in U.S. society. The state responded to the destabilizing crisis with social concessions, such as municipal hiring of Blacks and the repeal of the military draft. Because history is so complex, we cannot isolate all influences and precisely predict what would have happened if Huey Newton, Bobby Seale, and many others had not created the Black Panther Party. But we do know that without the Black Panther Party, we would now live in a very different world. The parts of this book analyze in turn the major phases of the political development of the Black Panther Party. Part 1, Organizing Rage, analyzes the period through May of 1967, tracing the party's development of its ideology of Black anti-imperialism and its preliminary tactic of policing the police. Part 2, Baptism in Blood, analyzes the party's rise to national influence through 1968, during which time it reinvented the politics of armed self-defense, championed black community self-determination, and promoted armed resistance to the state. Part 3, Resilience, and Part 4, Revolution Has Come, analyze the period through 1969 and 1970 when the party was at the height of its power, proliferating community service programs and continuing to expand armed resistance in the face of the state's intensified repression. We unpack the dynamics of repression and response in three cities, Los Angeles, Chicago, and New Haven, showing how the Panthers attracted support from multiracial allies at home and from revolutionary movements and governments abroad, and explaining why Black Panther insurgent practices were irrepressible. Part 5, Concessions and Unraveling, analyzes the demise of the Black Panther Party in the 1970s, showing how state concessions and broad political transformations undercut the party's resilience. During this period, the Black Panthers divided along ideological lines, with neither side able to sustain the politics that had driven the party's development. The concluding chapter sums up our findings and explores their implications for three broader contemporary debates about the history of the Black liberation struggle and about social movements generally. Finally, we consider the history of the Black Panther Party in light of Antonio Gramsci's theory of revolution, illuminating the political dynamics by which social movements become revolutionary, and explaining why there is no revolutionary movement in the United States today. Part 1, Organizing Rage. This is the genius of Huey Newton, of being able to tap this vast reservoir of revolutionary potential. I mean, street niggas, you dig it? Niggas who had been bad. Niggas who weren't scared because they ain't never knew what to be scared was. Because they been down in these ghettos and they knew to live, they had to fight. And so they been able to do that. But I mean to really tap it, to really tap it, to organize it, and then to direct it into an onslaught, a sortie against the power structure. This is the genius of Huey Newton. This is what Huey Newton did. Huey Newton was able to go down and to take the nigger on the street and to relate to him, understand what was going on inside of him, what he was thinking, and then implement that into an organization, into a program, and a platform, you dig it? Into the Black Panther Party, and then let it spread like wildfire across this country. Apprentice Bunchy Carter, leader of the Slauson Gang, and founder of the Los Angeles chapter of the Black Panther Party. 1. Huey and Bobby. On February 17, 1942, in Monroe, Louisiana, Huey P. Newton was born, the seventh and youngest child of Walter and Amelia Newton. Walter Newton was a paragon of responsibility. He held down two jobs at any given time, working in the gravel pit, the carbon plant, sugarcane mills, sawmills, and eventually as a brakeman for the Union Sawmill Company. On Sundays, he served as the minister at the Bethel Baptist Church in Monroe, where he and his family lived. He preached as the Spirit moved him, often promising to address his parishioners on a particular topic, then improvising an inspirational sermon salient to the moment. The rest of the time he spent with his family, the joy and purpose of his life. Amelia Johnson liked to say that she married young and finished growing up with her children. She was only 17 when she gave birth to her first child. The others soon followed. Unlike most black women in the South in the 1930s and 1940s, Amelia stayed at home, raising her children, seeing them through life's challenges, and relishing life's humor. The Newton family saw Amelia's not working as a domestic servant for whites as an act of rebellion. Walter Newton often used to say, "You can take a killing, but you can't take a beating." On one occasion, Walter Newton got into an argument with a younger white man for whom he worked about a detail of the job. The white man told him that when a colored disputed his word, he whipped him. Walter Newton replied that no man whipped him unless he was a better man, and he doubted that the white man qualified. The man was shocked at this uncharacteristic response and backed down. This was just one of the many times that Walter Newton defied whites in ways that often got blacks in the South lynched. He developed a reputation for being crazy, so whites steered clear of him, gaining him powerful respect among blacks. Newton's ability to challenge whites and stay alive is something of a mystery. One factor, according to Huey Newton, may have been his mixed race. Walter Newton's father was a white man who had raped his black mother. Thus, local whites knew his father, cousins, aunts, and blood relatives, and while they might not have hesitated to kill a black person, they may have been reluctant to shed his white family's blood. The Newtons moved to Oakland in 1945, following the path of many black families migrating from the South to the cities of the North and West to fill the jobs in the shipyards and industries that opened up with the onset of World War II. When the war ended, many blacks were laid off as wartime industry waned, and soldiers returning from the war created a labor surplus. Both new and expanded black communities in cities across the country rapidly sank into poverty. While the Newtons were better off than many of the black families they knew, they were poor, with seven children to feed, and often ate kush, a dish made of fried cornbread, several times a day. Making payments on the family's bills became Walter Newton's constant preoccupation. The Newton family was on the edge, and Huey looked to his older brothers for survival strategies. Each coped with ghetto life in a different way. Walter Newton Jr., the oldest, became a hustler, working outside legal channels to keep poverty at bay. He always dressed sharp, and he drove a nice car. Everyone in the neighborhood called him Sunny Man. Lee Edward gained a reputation as a street fighter before joining the military. He knew how to persist in the face of bad odds, always to look an adversary straight in the eye and to keep moving forward. Melvin Newton took a different path. He became a bookworm, went to college, and eventually taught sociology at Oakland's Merritt College. Huey P. Newton became all of these things, hustler, fighter, and scholar. From his oldest brothers, Lee Edward and Sunny Man, he mastered the ways of the street and learned how to fight. Through his teen years, Huey fought constantly. Unlike Melvin, Huey was not a bookworm. For years, he rebelled at school. By the time he entered the 11th grade, he still could not read, and his teachers often told him he was unintelligent. But outside of school, he had been learning how to think. With Melvin, he memorized and analyzed poetry. When a counselor in his high school told him he was not college material, Huey decided to prove him wrong. Over the next 2 years, through intense focus and will, he taught himself to read, graduated high school, and in 1959, enrolled in Merritt College. By the time Huey Newton became involved in the Afro-American Association at Merritt, he could debate theory as well as any of his peers. Yet, he had a side that most of the budding intellectuals around him lacked. He knew the street. He could understand and relate to the plight of the swelling ranks of unemployed, the brothers on the block, who lived outside the law. Newton's street knowledge helped put him through college, as he covered his bills through theft and fraud. But when Newton was caught, he used his book knowledge to study the law and defend himself in court, impressing the jury and defeating several misdemeanor charges. In 1962, at a rally at Merritt College opposing the U.S. blockade of Cuba, Newton's political life took a leap forward. There, he met fellow student Bobby Seale, with whom he would eventually found the Black Panther Party. The rally featured Donald Warden, leader of the Afro-American Association. Warden praised Cuba's Fidel Castro and voiced opposition to domestic civil rights organizations. After the speeches, an informal debate began among the students, during which Newton convinced Seale that the U.S. policy in Cuba was wrong and also made him question mainstream civil rights organizations. Newton impressed Seale with his command of the argument presented by E. Franklin Frazier in Black Bourgeoisie, a scathing critique of the black middle class that he read with Warden. Seale soon joined Warden's group. More than 5 years older than Newton, Bobby Seale was born in Dallas, Texas on October 22, 1936, the oldest of three siblings, and raised in Oakland. His father worked as a carpenter, and his mother also worked, sometimes as a caterer. Besides teaching Bobby how to build things and how to hunt and fish, Bobby's father also taught him about injustice, often beating him badly for no apparent reason. The arbitrary beatings filled Bobby with a rage for which he had few outlets. They also meant he had little to fear from fights. He had already tasted the worst. Rather than become a bully himself, from an early age, Bobby started to stand up for the little guy. When his family first moved to Oakland, a local bully pushed his little sister Betty off the swing. Despite being outnumbered in new territory, Bobby knocked the bully out of the swing and then told all the kids they could share the swing. Bobby had a penchant for taking on bullies, even when he had little hope of winning, once challenging a neighborhood kid twice his size who was cheating the smaller kids in marbles, and was often beaten to the ground. When he was 15, Bobby became close to a loner named Steve Brumfield. Steve told Bobby that the white man had stolen the land from the American Indians. The two of them escaped the pettiness and injustices at home and school by emulating Lakota warriors, running through the Berkeley Hills for hours every day, dressed in moccasins and beads, and fighting each other for sport. Bobby used metalworking skills he learned in a vocational program at Berkeley High School to make large knives and tomahawks that the two carried wherever they went. When they were not practicing fighting, they climbed trees and dreamed of moving to South Dakota, marrying American Indian women, and living off the land. Bobby had never felt happier. He quickly became fast and strong, and soon the bullies tried to stay out of his way. But after high school, Steve joined the military, and Bobby, lonely once again, drifted from city to city, job to job, and woman to woman. When things got hard, he ended up back at home with his parents. No longer willing to be pushed around by his father, and now perfectly able to defend himself, he joined the U.S. Air Force. While further developing his metalworking skills and mastering the use of firearms, he learned to contain and channel his rage, turning his explosive temper into cold calculation. When three soldiers refused to pay back a debt and threatened to beat Bobby if he mentioned the matter again, he suppressed his instinct to fight and bade his time. Later that week, Bobby attacked the main perpetrator when his defenses were down, nearly killing him with a pipe. Huey and Bobby both had their first serious political experiences with Donald Warden in the Afro-American Association. Warden had founded the All-Black Study Group while he was a student at Bolt Law School at the University of California, Berkeley, creating a space for in-depth discussion of books by black authors such as W.E.B. Du Bois, Ralph Ellison, Booker T. Washington, and James Baldwin. Warden asserted a black nationalist perspective inspired by Malcolm X, emphasizing racial pride and embracing a transcontinental black identity rooted in Africa. Warden believed in the virtues of black capitalism, arguing that black people must develop our own planned businesses where efficiency, thrift, and sacrifice are stressed. Feisty and charismatic, Warden challenged students and professors alike, debated groups such as the Young Socialist Alliance, and gave public lectures on black history and culture. Willing to debate anyone, Warden made a strong impression on fellow students and became an important intellectual influence on many of the future leaders of the Black Liberation Movement. In addition to Newton and Seale, association members included Leslie and Jim Lacey, Cedric Robinson, Richard Thorne, Ernest Allen, and Ron Everett, who later changed his name to Ron Karenga, founded the Black Cultural Nationalist Organization, U.S., and created the holiday Kwanzaa. Warden also became a mentor to James Brown in 1964, and through him, helped influence the politicization of soul music. The Afro-American Association produced local radio shows debating the concerns of Black America, regularly mobilized street corner rallies preaching racial consciousness to unemployed Blacks, and sponsored conferences entitled Mind of the Ghetto. At a September 1963 conference at McClyman's High School in Oakland, Cassius Clay, the future heavyweight boxing champion who would change his name to Muhammad Ali and have his title stripped for resisting the draft, was the featured speaker. But Newton was a man of action, and he grew dissatisfied with Warden's teaching. Newton felt that Warden was heavy on the talk, but ultimately could not be counted on. In Newton's view, Warden offered the community solutions that solved nothing, and he also doubted that much could be accomplished through Black capitalism. Soon he split from Warden in search of a new path. Rage. When Malcolm X was assassinated on February 21, 1965, Bobby's rage overflowed. He gathered 6 bricks from his mother's garden, broke them in half, and stood in wait at the corner, hurling bricks at the cars of any whites he saw passing by. "I'll make my own self into a motherfucking Malcolm X," he swore, "and if they want to kill me, they'll have to kill me." By then, the civil rights juggernaut had run its course. Throughout the early 1960s, in campaign after campaign, the civil rights movement successfully tore down the Jim Crow system of legal segregation. Activists crossed the color line with their bodies, drawing brutal repression from local white authorities and forcing the federal government to intervene, politically, legally, and militarily. But by the summer of 1964, the limits of civil rights political practice were becoming clear, particularly at the Democratic Convention in Atlantic City. As late as 1964, the Democratic Party in Mississippi excluded Blacks, all too often doling out violence or death to Blacks who attempted to register to vote. In the Freedom Summer campaign that year, leading civil rights organizations developed a parallel political party, the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, MFDP, that included Blacks as well as non-Blacks, and began registering Blacks to vote. 3 of the Freedom Summer activists, James Cheney, Michael Schwerner, and Andrew Goodman, were kidnapped, mutilated, and killed. Undaunted, the campaign continued. The MFDP held a state convention in Jackson in early August and selected 68 delegates to attend the upcoming Democratic National Convention in Atlantic City, New Jersey. President Johnson was determined to maintain white Southern support and worked to undermine the MFDP. On August 12th, Mississippi's Democratic governor, Paul B. Johnson, told the all-white Dixiecrat delegation that President Johnson had personally promised him not to seat the MFDP. The president refused to discuss the MFDP with civil rights leaders and instructed FBI Director Hoover to monitor the renegade party closely and provide regular updates on its activities to the White House. It became clear by the start of the convention that the MFDP would not win outright support in the Credentials Committee to seat its delegation in Atlantic City. But MFDP leaders hoped that a strong minority report from the committee would bring the issue to an open vote on the floor, and that, under the pressure of public scrutiny, convention delegates would at least vote to seat both delegations. On August 22nd, after intensive one-on-one lobbying of the state delegations, the MFDP presented its case to the Credentials Committee. Fannie Lou Hamer's testimony about the consequences of her efforts with the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, to register Mississippi Blacks' vote, in which she described how she was fired from her job and beaten in jail by Black prisoners under orders of the police, caught the nation's attention. "The first Negro began to beat, and I was beat until I was exhausted. After the first Negro was exhausted, the state highway patrolman ordered the second Negro to take the blackjack. The second Negro began to beat. I began to scream, and one white man got up and began to beat me on my head and tell me to hush. One white man, my dress had worked up high, he walked over and pulled my dress down, and he pulled my dress back up. All of this on account we want to register, to become first-class citizens, and if the Freedom Democratic Party is not seated now, I question America." The television audience responded almost instantly. Phones started to ring, and the delegates began receiving telegrams urging them to support the MFDP. Quickly, President Johnson called a press conference, and Hamer's testimony was cut off so the president's statement could be broadcast. Behind the scenes, the president's staff twisted the arms of Credentials Committee members while soon-to-be Vice President Hubert Humphrey called a meeting at the Pageant Motel across the street from the convention with Fannie Lou Hamer, Bob Moses, and the other MFDP leaders to discuss a compromise. Humphrey told them that the MFDP delegation would not be seated, but that educated professionals from the delegation, Aaron Henry of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, NAACP, and White Minister Ed King, would be given seats alongside the official all-white Mississippi delegation. Ms. Hamer would not be part of any official delegation. "The president will not allow that illiterate woman to speak from the floor of the convention," said Humphrey. The MFDP had not been consulted in the compromise offer, and the delegates rejected the proposal on the spot. Then someone knocked on the meeting room door and announced, "It's over." The MFDP leaders turned on the TV to see Minnesota Attorney General Walter Mondale, head of the Democratic Party committee appointed to resolve the MFDP challenge, announcing that the MFDP had accepted the compromise. Apparently, the Democratic Party leadership had timed the introduction of the issue on the convention floor to coincide with the MFDP leaders' meeting with Humphrey across the street, so that the leaders could not voice any opposition. Feeling deeply betrayed, SNCC and MFDP leader Bob Moses stormed out of the room, slamming the door in Hubert Humphrey's face. Civil rights mobilization played a central role in defeating legal segregation, and the Voting Rights Act of 1965 enfranchised Southern blacks. But for blacks outside the South, neither generated political gains or significant economic concessions. Even in its heyday in the early 1960s, the civil rights movement never significantly challenged de facto or customary economic and political exclusion in the black ghettos of the North and West. As de jure, or legal, segregation was defeated in the South, economic and political empowerment lagged, civil rights strategies lost their punch, and black activists across the country looked for other solutions. Many, including Newton and Seale, turned to Malcolm X. In December 1964, after the Atlantic City Convention, Malcolm X spoke at the Williams Institutional CME Church in Harlem on the same stage with Fannie Lou Hamer. In sharp contrast to the nonviolent tactics of the civil rights movement, Malcolm X suggested that black activists take up the revolutionary activities of the anti-colonial Mau Mau rebels in Kenya. "In my opinion, not only in Mississippi and Alabama, but right here in New York City, you and I can best learn how to get real freedom by studying how Kenyatta brought it to his people in Kenya, and how Odinga helped him, and the excellent job that was done by the Mau Mau freedom fighters. In fact, that's what we need in Mississippi. In Mississippi, we need a Mau Mau. In Alabama, we need a Mau Mau. In Georgia, we need a Mau Mau. Right here in Harlem, in New York City, we need a Mau Mau. We need a Mau Mau. If they don't want to deal with the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, then we'll give them something else to deal with. If they don't want to deal with the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, then we have to give them an alternative. Malcolm X developed a form of revolutionary black nationalism as a minister in the Nation of Islam, NOI. Maintaining a central focus on a black nationalist identity as advocated by the NOI, he came to see black liberation as part of the global struggle against Western imperialism, a stance that posed a challenge not only to the integrationist politics of the civil rights movement, but also to the NOI's tradition of abstaining from political controversy. Uncle Sam's hands are dripping with blood, dripping with the blood of the black man in this country. He's the earth's number one hypocrite. He has the audacity. Yes, he has. Imagine him posing as the leader of the free world. The free world. And you over here singing, "We Shall Overcome." Expand the civil rights struggle to the level of human rights. Take it into the United Nations, where our African brothers can throw their weight on our side, where our Latin American brothers can throw their weight on our side, and where 800 million Chinamen are sitting there waiting to throw their weight on our side. When he continued to strike this tone in public statements, becoming increasingly politically outspoken and controversial, his mentor, Elijah Muhammad, expelled Malcolm X from the NOI. Malcolm X's words resonated with many young blacks, especially those in the ghettos who had not seen the civil rights movement bring any noticeable change in their condition. He also spoke to the activists who felt betrayed by President Johnson and the federal government and were sick of turning the other cheek. "And now you're facing a situation where the young Negroes coming up," Malcolm X declared. "They don't want to hear that turn the other cheek stuff, no. There's a new deal coming. There's new thinking coming in. There's new strategy coming in. It'll be Molotov cocktails this month, hand grenades next month, and something else next month. It'll be ballots or it'll be bullets. It'll be liberty or it will be death. The only difference about this kind of death, it'll be reciprocal." In the 1960s, most black families, like the Newtons and the Seales, faced the peril of poverty. After migrating to the cities of the North and West to meet the demand for wartime jobs, thousands of black workers were left empty-handed when the war ended and the jobs evaporated. Many of the jobs that did remain followed whites fleeing to the suburbs, leaving sprawling black ghettos in their wake. Living in substandard housing and subjected to inferior and overcrowded schools, blacks were largely denied their rightful share of political power and economic opportunity. As unemployment increased, so did crime, and white urban politicians responded with strategies of containment, beefing up police patrols, and attacking crime through force. While President Johnson's Civil Rights Act and the supposed redress of black grievances were widely touted as success stories, the poverty, political exclusion, police brutality, and desperation of ghetto life had only intensified. As a result, many young urban blacks rejected civil rights politics as ineffectual and were drawn to the revolutionary nationalism of Malcolm X. When Malcolm X was gunned down in the Audubon Ballroom in Harlem in February 1965, he came to symbolize the struggle for black liberation, everything the civil rights movement promised but could not deliver. In the words of historian William L. Vandenberg, Malcolm's impassioned rhetoric was street smart. It had almost visceral appeal to a young, black, economically distressed constituency. Before his assassination, Malcolm constantly urged this constituency to question the validity of their schoolbook and media-inspired faith in an integrated American dream. Many responded. After his death, Malcolm's influence expanded dramatically. He came to be far more than a martyr for the militant separatist faith. He became a Black Power paradigm, the archetype, reference point, and spiritual advisor in absentia for a generation of Afro-American activists. In August 1965, 6 months after Malcolm X died, the Watts neighborhood in Los Angeles exploded in one of the largest urban rebellions in U.S. history. Black migrants had begun moving into Watts in the 1920s, creating a black island in a sea of white towns such as Southgate, Linwood, Compton, and Bell. Compton did have one black resident in 1930. Home lending regulations excluded blacks from obtaining mortgages to buy houses in white neighborhoods. By 1945, Watts was 80% black. Through the 1950s, the black migration continued, and more blacks migrated to California than to any other state. During this decade, the black population of New York City increased almost 2.5 times, and Detroit's black population tripled, while black LA grew 8-fold. Meanwhile, white residents fled in droves for the suburbs, taking capital and employment opportunities with them. Tensions between Watts residents and the police ran high. While the vast majority of Watts residents in 1965 were black, only 4% of the sworn personnel of the Los Angeles Police Department and 6% of the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department were black. Police Chief William Parker used analyses of crime data to develop and justify a policy that explicitly targeted Watts and other black neighborhoods for heavy police coverage, including intrusive techniques such as routine frisking of people on the street. "I don't think you can throw the genes out of the question when you discuss the behavior patterns of people," Parker wrote in 1957. Officers on the force called their nightsticks "nigger knockers." Residents of one of the most highly patrolled precincts called their area "Little Mississippi." The local NAACP reported, "Negroes in Los Angeles never know where or at what hour may come blows from the guardians of the law who are supposed to protect them." One activist recalled, "You just had to be black and moving to be shot by the police." Between January 1962 and July 1965, Los Angeles law enforcement officers, mostly police but also sheriff's deputies, highway patrol personnel, and others, killed at least 65 people. Of the 65 homicides by police that the Los Angeles Coroner's Office investigated during this period, 64 were ruled justifiable homicides. These included 27 cases in which the victim was shot in the back by law officers, 25 in which the victim was unarmed, 23 in which the victim was suspected of a nonviolent crime, and 4 in which the victim was not suspected of any crime at the time of the shooting. The only case that the coroner's inquest ruled to be unjustified homicide was one in which 2 officers, playing cops and robbers in a Long Beach police station, shot a newspaperman. The incident that sparked the Watts Rebellion was a traffic stop. 21-year-old Marquette Fry was driving his 1955 Buick along 116th Street near his family's house at 6 p.m. on August 11, 1965, when he was pulled over by a California Highway Patrol officer. His younger brother, Ronald Fry, the only passenger, had just been discharged from the U.S. Air Force. A crowd gathered, including Marquette's mother, Rena. More police arrived. Soon, a crowd of more than 200 had gathered, and the onlookers became agitated as the police reportedly slapped Rena Fry, beat her with a blackjack, and twisted her arm behind her back. Watts exploded. On August 12th, at 9:30 p.m., a group identifying itself as followers of Malcolm X arrived on Avalon Boulevard shouting, "Let's burn, baby, burn!" The next day, at 3:30 p.m., the Emergency Control Center Journal recorded 6 male Negroes firing rifles at helicopter from vehicle, 109th and Avalon. Governor Edmund Pat Brown cut short an aerial tour of South Los Angeles because of sniper fire. Delta Airlines rerouted flights over the city because rebels were shooting at planes. By the second day of the rebellion, according to the Los Angeles Times, more than 7,000 people were looting stores, in particular stealing guns, machetes, and other weapons. Rebels were filling glass bottles with gasoline and hurling Molotov cocktails at cars and stores, setting them on fire. Many were also firing shots at police. Fire trucks and ambulances that attempted to enter the area were attacked. During the heat of the battle, Police Chief Parker declared, "This situation is very much like fighting the Viet Cong. We haven't the slightest idea when this can be brought under control." One rebel, standing on the corner of Avalon and Imperial, made a different reference to Vietnam, telling an interviewer, "I've got my stuff, gun, ready. I'm not going to die in Vietnam. Whitey has been kicking ass too long." As the fires still burned, the local CBS radio station reported, "This was not a riot. It was an insurrection against all authority. If it had gone much further, it would have become civil war." The CBS Report's TV broadcast in December 1965 called it a virtual civil insurrection, probably unmatched since the Civil War. Scholars David O. Sears and John B. McConaughey noted that the legally constituted authority was overthrown. Sociologist Robert Blauner saw the rebellions as a preliminary, if primitive, form of mass rebellion against a colonial status. The rebellion spread out over 46.5 square miles. All told, 34 people, almost all black, were killed, many by police, and more than 1,032 were wounded. 3,952 people were arrested. The rebellion caused more than $40 million in property damage to over 600 buildings, completely destroying 200 of them. Full of rage at ghetto conditions, chafing against police repression, and frustrated with a civil rights politics unable to redress their situation, the Watts rebels sought to take matters into their own hands, forcefully rejecting the old guard civil rights leadership. Following the rebellion, Martin Luther King Jr. went to Watts to bring his vision of an integrated society and the tactics of nonviolence. On August 18th, he spoke to a meeting of 500 people at the Westminster Neighborhood Association. He began his appeal in rolling cadence. "All over America, the Negroes must join hands." "And burn," shouted a member of the audience. Throughout the evening, the audience repeatedly challenged and ridiculed King's appeal. Nonviolent activist and comedian Dick Gregory fared even worse in Watts. While the rebellion still flared, he borrowed a bullhorn from the police so that he could speak to the rebels. He attempted to calm them and pleaded, "Go home." The crowd did not respond kindly. A gunman in the crowd shot Gregory in the leg. The politics of nonviolence were failing. Commenting on the wave of urban rebellions and the rejection of civil rights strategies by disenchanted and dispossessed blacks, Paul Jacobs and Saul Landau observed, "The masses of poor Negroes remain an unorganized minority in swelling urban ghettos, and neither SNCC nor any other group has found a form of political organization that can convert the energy of the slums into political power." Armchair Revolutionaries. In Oakland in 1964, far away from Fannie Lou Hamer and the convention battles in Atlantic City, Huey Newton stabbed a man named Odell Lee with a steak knife at a party. At his trial, he claimed he had done so in self-defense, but the all-white jury was not convinced, and he spent 6 months in jail, mostly in solitary confinement because he would not obey orders from the guards. Newton later recalled finding a new sense of freedom in prison. The guards could lock up his body, but they could not cage his mind. Newton emerged from jail eager to embrace the new political ideas and organizations developing in Oakland. Newton soon reconnected with Seale, and the two joined the Seale Students Advisory Council, SSAC, founded by Ernie Allen. The council was a front group for the Revolutionary Action Movement, RAM, an anti-imperialist and Marxist black nationalist organization based in Philadelphia. Allen had collaborated with Newton and Seale in Warden's Afro-American Association when he was a student at Merritt College. After transferring to the University of California, Berkeley, Allen had traveled to Cuba in 1964 on a trip sponsored by the Progressive Labor Party. The contingent also included other radical black students from Detroit and around the country. In Cuba, Allen and the others met Max Stanford, the leader of RAM, who was there visiting his mentor Robert F. Williams, a pioneering advocate of armed black self-defense. Williams had moved to Cuba after local authorities, in collusion with the Ku Klux Klan and backed by the FBI, forced him to flee North Carolina. Allen got to know Stanford and Williams in Cuba, and through his intense conversations and debates with them, he found a way to move beyond the limits of Warden's Afro-American Association, embracing the idea that U.S. blacks could win their freedom by participating in a global revolution against imperialism. By the time he returned to the United States, Allen was committed to organizing a chapter of RAM in California. Ernie Allen, his brother Doug, Kenny Freeman, Mamadou Lumumba, and others began to build several front groups for RAM in the Bay Area. One project was Seale Book, the Revolutionary Journal of the Black World, a beautifully presented quarterly magazine of cultural criticism and political theory, whose content ranged from essays on the significance of John Coltrane to analyses of the writings of Frantz Fanon. Both poetry and black revolutionary nationalist artwork graced the magazine. Virtual Morel, Alex Papillon, Isaac Moore, and other friends of Newton and Seale at Merritt also joined the SSAC and helped launch a campaign to create courses in Afro-American studies at the college. The Merritt student body was predominantly black, and there was a large demand for such courses. The demand for Afro-American studies cut across intra-black differences and garnered support from many black individuals and organizations. The administration put up resistance, but hundreds of students turned out for meetings and protests, and the administration slowly began making concessions, including development of a black studies curriculum. Working with RAM exposed Newton and Seale to a new world of writings and ideas. Both had been strongly influenced by the thinking of Malcolm X and the readings in the Afro-American Association. But unlike the association, RAM was a revolutionary nationalist organization with a strong socialist and anti-imperialist bent. Guided by the political ideas of Robert F. Williams, RAM exposed Newton and Seale to the key writings of revolutionary nationalism, and they were particularly attracted to the writings of Frantz Fanon, Mao Zedong, and Che Guevara, as well as RAM's own publications on revolutionary black nationalism, including articles by Max Stanford and Robert Williams. The Revolutionary Action Movement advanced a pivotal idea that would become central to the politics of the Black Panther Party. Drawing on a line of thought reaching back at least to the mid-1940s and the black anti-colonialism of W.E.B. Du Bois, Paul Robeson, and Alpheus Hunton, RAM argued that black America was essentially a colony and framed the struggle against racism by blacks in the United States as part of the global anti-imperialist struggle against colonialism. Max Stanford defined the politics of revolutionary black nationalism this way in 1965. "We are revolutionary black nationalists, not based on ideas of national superiority, but striving for justice and liberation of all the oppressed peoples of the world. There can be no liberty as long as black people are oppressed, and the peoples of Africa, Asia, and Latin America are oppressed by Yankee imperialism and neocolonialism. After 400 years of oppression, we realize that slavery, racism, and imperialism are all interrelated, and that liberty and justice for all cannot exist peacefully with imperialism." The politics of RAM connected the struggles of black Americans with liberation struggles abroad. Whereas black soldiers returning from World War II helped catalyze the civil rights movement by arguing that if they could die fighting for their country, then they should be considered full citizens upon their return, RAM insisted that blacks were not full citizens in the United States. RAM viewed black America as an independent nation that had been colonized at home. Because black Americans were colonial subjects rather than citizens, RAM argued, they owed no allegiance to the U.S. government and thus should not fight in the Vietnam War. On July 4, 1965, RAM wrote an open statement to the Vietnamese National Liberation Front, declaring the independence of black America from the United States and asserting its solidarity with the Vietnamese struggle against American imperialism. In a separate statement that day, RAM addressed blacks in the military, arguing that if they should be fighting against anyone, it should be the U.S. government for the liberation of black America. "Why should we go anywhere to fight for the racist U.S. government, only to return home and be faced with murder, rape, castration, and extermination? How can the racist U.S. government talk about freeing anyone when the U.S. government practices racism against black Americans every day? If the U.S. government says it cannot protect us from local and national racists, then let your battle assignment be against those who are abusing your children, wives, mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, and loved ones." RAM and its front group, the SSAC, identified a common cause between blacks and the Vietnamese, and they were on the cutting edge of early opposition to the Vietnam War. Before there was any significant draft resistance, they criticized the draft and organized a campaign to oppose the drafting of black men into the military, holding rallies for the cause, including one at Merritt College on April 26, 1966, featuring local organizers Alex Papillon and Mark Comfort. Through its honorary chair in exile, Robert F. Williams, RAM began building relationships with anti-imperialist leaders around the world. Williams had served as president of the local NAACP chapter in Monroe, North Carolina. As Jim Crow came under growing attack by the civil rights movement, the Ku Klux Klan, with the support of the local white government, increasingly relied on violence to protect racial segregation. With no support from the federal government, Williams turned to the skills he had learned as a private first class in the Marine Corps to turn the tide, arming himself and other members of his NAACP chapter. Williams and the Monroe NAACP fought several armed battles in self-defense against whites. In 1961, facing dubious criminal charges and threatened by a lynch mob that promised to kill him for his activities, Williams fled North Carolina. Williams found asylum in Cuba and soon met Mao Zedong in China. Mao was deeply impressed with Williams and saw a common cause in the struggle for black liberation in the United States and the global struggle against imperialism. In 1963, Mao articulated this position in an essay he wrote at Williams's behest, asking the people of the world to recognize the black liberation struggle in the United States as part of the global struggle against imperialism. Robert Williams's life exemplified a different approach to politics than that of RAM, and Williams's memoir, Negroes with Guns, greatly influenced Newton. Newton was deeply impressed by Williams's courage in standing up to the lynch mobs, but he was not sure how to apply this political approach to the ghettos of the North and West. He wanted to organize poor blacks. He wanted to mobilize the brothers on the block, the unemployed black men seen on every street of the ghetto, the black underclass. These were the people who faced the brutality of the expanding urban police departments. And many were the same folks who had rioted in Watts. RAM claimed to be talking for them, but it was not reaching them or moving them to action. Newton did not yet know how to mobilize these brothers on the block. But given what he knew of his brother, Sunnyman, he believed that they would understand armed self-defense, that they would understand the language of the gun. The Revolutionary Action Movement led the way in developing revolutionary black nationalist thought in the United States in the 1960s. But the group's practical application of these ideas was limited. RAM leaders fashioned themselves as revolutionaries. They read socialist and anti-imperialist texts and raised the possibility of urban guerrilla warfare. Some evidence indicates that RAM members attempted to implement these ideas, but most of them were intellectuals like Huey's brother Melvin. They rarely emphasized practical action, and when they did, they oriented their efforts toward students. Huey soon became dissatisfied with the group's inability to appeal to the brothers on the block and sought new ways to meld theory with on-the-ground action. Huey and Bobby wanted to challenge police brutality directly, and they found some inspiration in the activities of Mark Comfort and Curtis Lee Baker, talented young organizers who had emerged from traditional civil rights organizations in Oakland. Comfort and Baker had begun appealing to young African Americans with militant style, adopting black outfits and berets in early 1966, and with challenges to police brutality. In February 1965, Comfort organized a protest to put a stop to police beating innocent people. A crowd of more than 200, mostly high school students, encircled the Oakland Hall of Justice, urging Governor Pat Brown to make a full-scale investigation of police brutality. That August, Baker and others demanded that the Oakland City Council keep white policemen out of black neighborhoods. During that summer, Comfort organized citizen patrols to monitor the actions of the police and document incidents of brutality. When people were arrested, he followed them to the jail and bailed them out. He soon abandoned the tactic, though, because it was too costly. On Thursday night, March 17, 1966, at approximately 9 p.m., Newton and Seale and a friend they called Weasel were walking on Telegraph Avenue in Berkeley, just north of Oakland, headed toward the University of California campus. The street was a small bohemian mecca with students, hippies, and young people congregating and milling about in the restaurants, cafes, bars, and shops. With encouragement from Huey and Weasel, Bobby stood on a chair outside the Forum restaurant near the corner of Telegraph and Haste and began to recite Ronald Stone's black anti-war poem, "Uncle Sammy, call me full of Lucifer. You school my naive heart to sing red, white, and blue stars and stripes, songs, and to pledge eternal allegiance to all things blue, true. Blue-eyed blonde, blonde-haired, white chalk, white skin with USA tattooed all over. I will not serve." The poem struck a chord. The war was escalating, and many students felt conflicted, scared, and angry about the draft. A crowd began to gather. Soon, more than 25 people were cheering Bobby on and asking him to recite the poem again. George Williamson, an off-duty police officer, pushed into the crowd and grabbed Seale. A scuffle broke out. More police arrived. Newton and Seale were both arrested for disturbing the peace. Virtual Morell withdrew $50 from the SSAC treasury and bailed them out. A few weeks later, Newton and Seale saw a policeman pushing around a black man for no apparent reason. The officer arrested the man and took him to the station. Following Mark Comfort's example, Newton and Seale went to the station and bailed the man out, using money from the SSAC treasury. The brother started to cry, and it touched Bobby deeply. Bobby was fed up with the armchair intellectualizing and wanted to stand up against the police, recalling, "I was filled with a staunch belief of the need for brotherhood and revolution and rebellion against the racist system." Huey and Bobby were ready to take meaningful, on-the-ground action. Seeking to emulate Robert Williams's defiant stance, Newton proposed that the SSAC organize a rally for Malcolm X's birthday in May 1966 and wear loaded guns in the spirit of his call for armed self-defense. Newton believed that this would attract the brothers on the block to participate. Seale supported Newton's proposal, but Kenny Freeman and the other RAM leaders flatly rejected it. Perhaps feeling threatened, Freeman and other RAM leaders suggested that Newton and Seale had misused money from the SSAC treasury. That was the last straw. Already frustrated with the failure of the local RAM leadership to stand up to police brutality, the organization's lack of support during the fray on Telegraph Avenue, and its inability to organize brothers on the block, Bobby and Huey confronted Freeman and the others, and then left the SSAC. Epiphany. In the summer of 1966, Seale was hired to run a youth work program at the North Oakland Neighborhood Anti-Poverty Center, funded by the Federal War on Poverty. Through his role as a social service provider, he came to understand even more clearly the economic and social needs of black youth. Beyond delivering services, Bobby brought his revolutionary nationalist theory to the job and used the opportunity to push up against the ideological bias in the government program. Rather than merely guiding young blacks into a government-prescribed path, he used his authority to help them stand up against oppressive authority, particularly against police brutality. One day, Seale's boss instructed him to take a group of young black men and women on a tour of the local police station. When the group arrived, the police officers pulled out notepads and pencils and started to interview the teenagers about the character of gangs in the neighborhood. Seale protested, instructing his group to remain silent and announcing that his program would not be used as a spy network to inform on people in the community. The officers claimed that they simply wanted to foster better relations with the community. In response, Seale turned the conversation around, creating an opportunity for the teenagers to describe their experiences with police brutality in the neighborhood. It was the first time the young people had had the opportunity to look white police officers in the eye and express their anger and frustration. One teenager berated the police for an incident in which several officers had thrown a woman down and beaten her in the head with billy clubs. "Say you," said a 16-year-old girl, pointing at a policeman. "You don't have to treat him like that," Seale said to the girl. "I'll treat him like I want to, because they done treated me so bad," she replied. Bobby sat back as the girl grilled the officer about whether he had received proper psychiatric treatment. The officer turned red and started to shake. "The way you're shaking now," she said, "the way you're shaking now and carrying on, you must be guilty of a whole lot. And I haven't got no weapon or nothing." The poverty program provided a paycheck, some skills, and an opportunity to work with young people. But Newton and Seale were still searching for a way to galvanize the rage of the brothers on the block. They wanted to mobilize the ghetto the way that the civil rights movement had mobilized blacks in the South. They dreamt of creating an unstoppable force that would transform the urban landscape forever. The problem was now clear to Huey and Bobby, but they did not yet have a solution. Huey and Bobby were not the only ones looking for answers. Within a year of the Watts Rebellion, the younger generation of Black liberation activists had widely rejected the goals of integration and the tactics of nonviolence. On June 5, 1966, James Meredith, the first Black student to gain admission to the University of Mississippi, was shot on his solo march from Memphis to Jackson. Civil rights leaders Martin Luther King Jr. and Stokely Carmichael flew to Memphis to take up his march, and they were soon joined by Black liberation activists from around the country, as well as many local Blacks. As the march proceeded, a split began to emerge between the old guard civil rights leaders, represented by King, and the younger wing, represented by Carmichael. The younger activists wanted the march to be a Blacks-only event, and they also wanted the Deacons of Defense, a militant Black organization that promoted armed self-defense, to provide protection for the marchers. These were significant departures from the civil rights integrationist frame and nonviolent tactics. As the march made its way to Greenwood, Mississippi, Carmichael and a group of activists were arrested and held in jail for 6 hours. Upon their release, Carmichael announced to a rally of supporters, "This is the 27th time I have been arrested. I ain't going to jail no more. What we gonna start saying now is Black power." Willie Ricks, a SNCC activist, took up the phrase and called it out. "What do you want?" The crowd replied, "Black power." The phrase caught on like wildfire. The old guard civil rights leaders soon acknowledged the shift. King even appealed to the government for help. "The government has got to give me some victories if I'm going to keep people nonviolent. I know I'm going to stay nonviolent no matter what happens. But a lot of people are getting hurt and bitter, and they can't see it that way anymore." Black power was not so much an answer as a new way of framing the quest for Black liberation. No one knew quite what Black power was or how to achieve it. But the younger generation of Black activists put their minds and energies to figuring it out. By 1966, racial tensions were rising in Oakland. Mayor John Redding called the city council to his office for a special meeting to warn its members that if communication between the city government and low-income Blacks did not improve, Oakland would become another Watts. Amory Bradford, a Johnson administration official sent to Oakland in 1966 to develop a federal plan for reducing racial tensions, reported, "Experts sent by the president to survey conditions in other ghettos picked Oakland as one of those most likely to be the next Watts." Another visiting white official described Oakland as a powder keg. One Economic Development Administration outreach flyer widely distributed in West Oakland in 1966 read, "Let's talk about problems." Eugene R. Foley, U.S. Department of Commerce, President Johnson's troubleshooter, wants to talk to you to prevent a Watts in Oakland. That fall, word spread that Oakland police officers had beaten a Black girl during the arrest of her brother. A large crowd of disgruntled youths began to gather. They soon laid siege to a 10-block area on East 14th Street, smashing windows, attacking cars, and throwing gasoline bombs. 60 police officers arrived on the scene and arrested 12 people. On September 27, 1966, 16-year-old Matthew Johnson was pulled over by police in Hunters Point, a Black neighborhood across the bay in San Francisco. Johnson and his friends had stolen a car and were cruising around the neighborhood. When police pulled them over, the teens panicked and fled. Matthew Johnson was shot in the back by police and was left bleeding on the ground for more than an hour. By the time ambulances arrived, he was dead. The neighborhood erupted in a rebellion that went on for several days. Using bricks and Molotov cocktails, rebels damaged or destroyed 31 police cars and 10 fire department vehicles. The police arrested 146 people, injuring 42, 10 of them with gunshots. The situation was unbearable. Newton and Seale would tolerate no more police brutality and were fed up with the disorganized and impotent attempts of the black community to resist. They were determined to find a solution. Newton soon experienced an epiphany, sparked by an article he read in the August 1966 edition of the West Coast SNCC newspaper, The Movement, about the Community Alert Patrol, CAP, in Watts. Brother Lenny and Brother Crook, two activists from Watts, organized CAP after the rebellion in 1965 to prevent further police brutality. CAP members monitored the police, driving around the black neighborhoods of Watts with notepads and pencils, documenting police activities. In August 1966, CAP began displaying a Black Panther logo on its patrol vehicles, inspired by SNCC's use of the Panther symbol when helping to organize an independent black political party in Lowndes County, Alabama. CAP was not left alone to carry out its activities, however. It was vulnerable to harassment and abuse by the police. One frustrated CAP member commented on the police harassment to a movement reporter. "There's only one way to stop all this," he said, "and that's to get out our guns and start shooting." Newton had been studying law at Merritt College and San Francisco State College.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.